Thank you. Praise the Lord.
We want to thank you for tuning in here at Unity Church of God in Christ for our pastors, Anthony Rogers and his beautiful wife, Charlene Rogers. We'll go into a word of prayer. Father God, we thank you for another day.
Thank you.
Lord, we want to thank you for another day.
Thank you.
Lord, you're doing a new thing in the earth, God.
Thank
you. Oh God, no fear and the news is saying about another coronavirus going to sweep the land, but God, your power is sweeping the land.
Yes.
God, we focus on what you're doing, God.
Yes.
We come against every distraction of the enemy, God.
Yes.
Oh God, you want people focused to get off of you. Oh God, but today, God, we made our mind up to follow you. We don't care what the news is saying, but God, we read and we're studying. We seek in your face like we never seek it before. God, there's a supernatural power that's ready to manifest in the land. Oh God, your enemies is in trouble. Oh God, they gone following things. Oh God, they getting to the point where they reaching at the bottom of the barrel. Oh God, we know that you're soon to return. You're telling us to be ready. Oh God, we pray for the mothers of Zion. Oh God, it was heavy on our heart this morning. The mothers, God, the mothers, God. If it had not been for the mothers, God, the one that carried us the altar, to make sure that we got the Holy Ghost. The mothers, God, that stood by our side when we missed it, God. They told us, get back right here, God. The mothers, God. Oh God, watch over them, God. They are not forgotten. Oh God, touch them right now. Oh God, remember the mothers of Zion. Oh God, if it had not been for them, God, some of us would not be preaching today. If it had not been for some of the mothers, God, we wouldn't have the love of God the way we do. Remember the mothers today, God. Oh God, remember them, God. Oh God, touch their hearts this morning. Oh God, and go through the afflictions right now. Deliver them, God. Oh God, we thank you for the fathers of Zion, the deacons, the ministers, the elders. Oh God, remember them, God. Oh God, let none be forgotten, God. It don't matter how big or small works they may done, it means a lot to you, God. Oh God, remember, remember, remember your people, God. Oh, some is on the sideline. They feel abandoned, God. They feel like I can't fit in. But God, let them know they are important unto you. God, and Lord, we thank you.
Thank you.
Pray for the man of God this morning. Our pastor, as he come forth, God. Oh God, give him the words of fire from heaven, God. Oh God, oh God, oh God. You're doing a new thing in him, God. It's springing forth like wells of water. Oh God, continue to use him in a mighty way. Continue, God, stir up the gifts you put in him, God. Oh God, and continue to move with power and authority under the power of the Holy Ghost. Let him speak what thus says the Lord. Remember his wife that stands by his side, a mighty woman. Oh God, that stirred up gifts in her. Oh God, desires. Oh God, that's of you. Oh God, she's moving forward in the things of God. His daughter, his son. Oh God, they all moving in the same direction of one accord. Things is coming together. The impossible is manifesting. Remember the unity family. Oh God, we support the man of God. Help us, God, to continue to be faithful. Continue to be diligent. Oh God, we thank you. We give you the service in Jesus' name. We pray. Amen.
Amen. I've been reading to you the 34th division of Psalms.
Yes.
The first through the fourth verse. And it reads, I will bless the Lord at all times.
Yes.
His praises shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me.
Yes.
And let us exalt his name together.
Yes, yes.
I sought the Lord, and he heard me, and delivered me from all my fears.
Yes.
I read to you Psalms, the 34th division of Psalms, the first through the fourth verse. May God have blessed you to reading and to hearing of His word on this morning.
Amen. Morning, Unity. I will be reading the New Testament this morning. This morning's scripture is Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 5. And it reads, "Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand, and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. And not only so, but we glory in tribulations also, knowing that tribulation worketh patience, and patience experience, and experience hope. And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. May God add a blessing to the reading and doing of His word."
Good morning, Unity. I will be reading our statement of faith. We believe the Bible to be the inspired and only infallible written word of God. We believe that there is only one God, eternally existing in three persons: God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. We believe in the blessed hope, which is the rapture of the church of God, which is in Christ at His return. We believe that the only means of being cleansed from sin is through repentance, faith in the precious blood of Jesus Christ. We believe that regeneration by the Holy Ghost is absolutely essential for personal salvation. We believe that the redemptive work of Christ on the cross provides healing for the human body in answer to believing prayer. We believe in the baptism of the Holy Spirit according to Acts 2:4. It's given to believers who ask for it. We believe in the sanctifying power of the Holy Spirit, by whose indwelling the Christian is enabled to live a holy and separated life in this present world.
Good morning, Unity. The Unity musicians will be performing a musical selection for you. The first selection we'll be playing is called Every Praise.
Thank you.
Happy birthday to all those that are having a birthday this month. Rejoice in the Lord, for this day is your day. This month is your month. So give God praise for your birthday. We here at Unity, we would like for you this year, since God has blessed you all year to make it to this point, we would like you to enhance your life as you go forth this next year. Empower someone and encourage someone. That person who is down, who don't think that they'll make it. That person that you know that is having trouble, let them know how God has blessed you this year. Encourage them so that they may go on, so they may rejoice with you in your birthday as they have theirs. Amen, saints? And again, every praise is to our God. Happy birthday on today. Amen.
Two or three. Stop me in the midst if you do what? Such an answer. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Thank God we got more than two or three, so I know we can get it. Amen. Hallelujah up in here this morning. Amen. Well, I promised the Lord that I would
Made a sacrifice to trust you and believe on your word. We thank you at this moment for those that even though they're hurting within their heart, even though things might not seem as glorious as they would like it, they yet believe that you are God. But God, we also thank you for those that are on the fence, trying to decide. Thank you for giving them another day to allow them to make up their mind. Thank you for having mercy on them so they can come into the throne of grace. Lord, thank you that you reign on everyone. It does not matter how much, but Lord, their dependence and faith on you. Obedience, Lord, thank you. Obedience, Lord, thank you for their obedience. For if they trust and lean on you, all things work towards the good. And so, Lord, we give you all glory. We give you all honor. Lord, in the name of Jesus, continue to watch over us. Continue to hide us, Lord. And I ask you, Lord, give them favor right now. In thy son Jesus' name, amen and amen.
Morning Unity. The Unity musicians will be performing our second musical selection. This musical selection is called Pray For Me. Thank you.
for me. While you're down on your knees, would you pray for me? I ask you to stand as we read the Word of God. Second Kings chapter 4, just reference verses 1 through 7. King James, and then I'll quickly get through the NIV. Now there cried a certain woman of the wives of the sons of the prophets unto Elijah, saying, Thy servant, my husband, is dead, and thou knowest that thy servant did fear the Lord, and the creditor is come to take unto him my two sons to be bondsmen. And Elijah said unto her, What shall I do for thee? Tell me, what hast thou in the house? And she said, Thy handmaid hath not anything in the house save a pot of oil. Then he said, Go, borrow thee vessels abroad of all thy neighbors, even empty vessels. He says, Borrow not a few. When thou act come in, thou shalt shut the door upon thee and upon thy sons, and shalt pour out into all those vessels, and thou shalt set aside that which is full. Verse 5. So she went from him and shut the door upon her and upon her sons, who brought the vessels to her, and she poured out. 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 6 and verse 7. And it came to pass, when the vessels were full, that she said unto her son, Bring me yet a vessel. And he said unto her, There is not a vessel more. And they all stayed. Then she came and told the man of God, and he said, Go, sell the oil. Pay thy debt, and live thou and thy children on the rest. 2 Kings chapter 4, verses 1 through 7, the NIV reads swiftly. The wife of a man from the company of the prophets cried out to Elijah, Your servant, my husband, is dead, and you know that he revered the Lord. But now his creditor is coming to take my two boys as his slaves. Elijah replied to her, How can I help you? Tell me, what do you have in your house? Your servant has nothing there at all, she said, except a little oil. Elijah said, Go around and ask all your neighbors for empty jars. He says, Don't ask for just a few. Then go inside and shut the door behind you and your sons. Pour oil into all the jars, and as each is filled, put it one aside. She left him and afterwards shut the door behind her and her sons, and they brought the jars to her, and she kept pouring. When all the jars were full, she said to her sons, Bring me another one. But he replied, There is not a jar left. Then the oil stopped flowing. Verse 7, she went and told the man of God, and he said, Go, sell the oil and pay your debts. You and your sons can live on what is left. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this moment. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity. Lord, we thank you that you may be able to anoint the word that it's made for each and every one. Give them their own personal revelation. Lord, it is at this moment when sometimes we feel the most isolated, sometimes we feel the most separated from you. This is the time that even though we're holding on, yet we need a word. A word to encourage, a word to inspire, a word that will allow us just to go a little bit further. Lord, we're simply asking that you would come and give us your grace. You would come and give us your anointing. God, you would come and guide us. Lord, I pray that your word goes to each and everyone that is in place and needs to hear. So Lord, start with me. Take anything out of me. Mold me, Lord. I am just a conduit. And we will give you all honor and glory. someone right now is just simply reaching out, looking for someone to pray for them, looking for someone to encourage them, looking for someone to lift them up. And you are right on time, God. Just in time, God. Right when you think you're at your lowest type of God. Lord, you are a miracle worker. And so, Lord, we stretch out our hand of faith unto you. And we ask you to abide with us, guide us, and to give us your holy grace. In thy son Jesus' name, amen and amen. You may be seated. Our text this time that we have together, 2 Kings chapter 4, verses 1 through 7. It's speaking from a particular title that causes us to examine not only ourselves, but those things that are around us. Those things that we might overlook, those things that we may not take time to really identify with. Our title, this moment that we have together, forces us to awaken and not just glance at what we have, but not just by happenstance try to understand what God has for us, but it causes us just to take a step back and to be honest and for us to really examine those things that are about. So our simple title this morning is just a question, not meant to belittle, not meant to praise, not meant to lift anyone else up, but it's just a simple personal question that is asked of each and every one of us. Our title this time that we have together is very simple. What's in your house? What's in your house? This is not about your mother. This is not about your father or your favorite aunt. This one is for you. What is in your house? See, a house is a reference to a dwelling or your body. It can be a motorhome, an apartment, a condo, a townhouse, and for some people yet who are struggling, even their car. This dwelling we reside in takes on a personal feel when we place certain things into it. This place, this dwelling, this house, based on what is put inside, becomes a home, a place where some free feel safe.
Yes, sir.
See, remember, this house in our particular text also has another meaning. It's a reference to you yourself, the dwelling that we allow God to rest inside our body. There isn't a commercial. There's a commercial. I don't know if you have seen it. There's a commercial where an actress or an actor begins by sharing the benefits of their credit card that they represent. See, they point out the benefits. They say things like unlimited double miles, and they point out other benefits by simply saying that you can get the double miles on any and every purchase, and you don't have to wait, but every day you can make it happen.
All right, man.
They point out the negatives. They say that you don't have to worry about some of the other cards who have rotating categories or limitations of what you can purchase, or even that you have to sign up. They simply said that this card has no games. They usually accompanied by someone else within that commercial. That someone else in that commercial begins to listen to what is being said, and then they respond to what their current card can do. They usually respond in a negative way, and they'll say something like, my card only gives me double miles on just airline purchases. My card makes me sign up. My card has rotating categories. The actor or the actress at this point simply points out and gives examples of what their card can do that they represent. Then after breaking down They have acknowledged what their card can do. And they force you to look and address at what your card cannot do. They have exposed you to thinking process. They have exposed you to maybe a decision that has been made. They have given you a question that they're about to ask of you that provokes your thought process.
All right, preacher.
And so they simply leave you with this comment. They simply ask you, what's in your wallet? This particular company would like for you to feel that you have just been exposed to information. So they want you to self-examine your current choices. This particular company would like for you to self-examine all of your options. This particular company would like for you to compare their particular credit card benefits to your current credit card benefits. This particular company would like for you to seriously consider replacing your current credit card with their specific product. Like this particular company, I, Pastor Rogers, would like to ask you the thought-provoking question. What is actually in your house? Like that particular company, I would like for you to self-examine the current choices that you have made within your life. Like that particular company, I would like for you to self-examine the options that you have available to you for your spiritual life. Like that particular company, I would like for you to compare God's benefits to your current self-relying benefits. Like that particular company, I would like for you to seriously consider replacing your current spiritual life, your current habits, your current choices. I would like for you to think about not relying on yourself, but begin the process of relying on God.
Yes, sir.
Uncertainty, despair, and anxiety, it is only temporary when you trust God. Uncertainty, despair, and anxiety, it is only temporary when you trust God. Our text begins with a woman. Our text begins with a widow. Our text begins with a mother with uncertainty. A mother who is filled with worry.
Yes, sir.
A mother who has apprehension. A mother who has anguish. Our text opens with a mother in an emotional state.
Yes, sir.
Mother who is in distress.
Yes, sir.
A mother who has a feeling of hopelessness. This mother is concerned about her kid's fate.
Yes, sir.
Our text begins with a mother who cries out with agony to the prophet Elijah.
Yes, sir.
I am concerned that there are others who feel like that mother.
All right, preach up.
A feeling of weariness that's within our homes. A feeling of hopelessness that is within our lives. A feeling of apprehension that even grips us within our community. I am concerned that there are others who have a feeling of uneasiness,
yes,
a feeling of distress, a feeling of anguish. I am concerned that some of us simply have despair. Yes, yes, I am concerned. I am concerned that you might not know that in your time of distress, you can call out to God. I am concerned that you might not know that in your time of confusion, you can call out to God. I am concerned that you might not simply know that when you have that feeling of hopelessness, that God is right there. All you got to do is call out. See, within our text, an emotional mother in despair cries out to the prophet Elijah. It is in 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 2 that we hear Elijah replied to her. Steps back and he hears the call and he asks, how can I help you? She's explaining what is happening, but then he asks her a specific question. He says, tell me, what do you have in your house? See, your servant, the handmaid, said, I don't have too much. All I have is a little bit oil. But at this intersection of the question causes us to examine those things that God might have planted, those things that we thought was not necessary, those things that when we heard about reading our Bible, when we heard about fasting and praying, and we heard about set aside time, what's in your house? What do you have that God can work with? I wonder what exactly is in your house that you sometimes overlook. I wonder what exactly that is in your house that God really can use.
Yeah,
right. I wonder what's in your house that you feel at this moment that is insignificant.
Uh-huh.
I wonder, have you examined what it is in your house?
Uh-huh.
Elijah informed the distressed mother. He says, go borrow every jar you can get your hands on.
Uh-huh.
Get every empty jar that you can get.
Yes, sir.
To the widow, she did not feel that it was significant to understand. I don't have too much and you want me to get jars? But she obeyed the word of the Lord.
Uh-huh.
God, I am not that elegant. Obey the word of a God.
Uh-huh.
Elijah informed this anguished mother that God is about to use what was already in her house. She didn't quite understand, but God was going to take the things that she already had to relieve her of her trouble.
Uh-huh.
Elijah informed the troubled mother, if you obey, your victory is on its way.
Yes, sir.
See, Elijah wanted to reduce the anxiety within the mother's heart and within the mother's mind. Elijah wanted to reduce the uncertainty within the mother's heart. Elijah wanted to reduce the despair within the mother's mind. Just like the prophet Elijah, I also would like to reduce the anxiety that's within our own hearts. The anxiety that is in our own minds. Let us reduce the uncertainty within our hearts. The uncertainty that we carry, the hesitation within our minds, don't have to exist. We can reduce the despair that we carry sometimes within our own hearts. I need you to believe that God is about to use what is already inside of you. Need you to understand that God will take those things that you have been holding on to and he has relieving you of. God is going to use those same things to relieve you of your troubles. All you have to do is trust God. All you have to do is trust God. All you have to do is trust God. You need to know that even though you may feel unsure and anxious, if you obey God, the victory is already on its way. Understand within our text, this woman who felt all alone. This woman who felt all alone and didn't know what was going to happen obeyed God's word.
Yes, sir.
This widow now, this widow that has no income, obeys God's word and believed it would resolve her predicament.
Yes, sir.
This mother who had two sons that were about to become slaves. This mother that had two sons that were about to become slaves. This mother who did not have a savings account. This mother did not have a checking account. This mother's credit had been used up and her sons were becoming slaves. This mother that looked at all options and there were none left and they were on their way to take her firstborn. Was on her way to take the second child. This mother that had fought the diseases when they were young.
Yes, sir.
This mother that made sure they were provided for.
Yes, sir.
This mother that had mended all of their wounds and stayed up late with them and showed them how to read and write. This is the mother that sat there in anguish.
Yes, sir.
But this same mother began to trust in the word of God.
All right, preacher.
This same mother decided that I will die with the belief that God can make a difference in my life.
All right.
This mother put it all on the line.
Uh-huh.
The Bible says that the bondsman was coming.
Uh-huh.
The Bible says that the bondsman was coming.
Uh-huh.
It wasn't much time to wait. I had just one shot. And I'm going to trust in God. I wonder if you're willing.
Uh-huh.
I wonder if you're willing to obey God's word.
Uh-huh.
Wonder if you're willing to obey God's word to resolve your predicament. Are you willing to obey God's word when you feel abandoned?
All right, then.
I wonder if you yourself is willing.
All right.
Wonder, are you willing to obey God's word to resolve your predicament?
Uh-huh.
How about would you obey his word when you feel hollow on the inside?
Yeah,
I wonder if you are willing.
Uh-huh.
I wonder if you're willing to obey God's word.
Yeah, all right.
Really, are you willing to obey his word to resolve your predicament? How about when you feel overburdened? Are you willing to obey his word?
Right,
I wonder if you have decided
yeah.
to trust in God.
Uh-huh.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yes, sir.
But what happens when life changes?
Yeah.
What do you do when you have relied on certain things and those things have been removed from you?
Uh-huh.
What do you do when the job is gone? What do you do when your health is in trouble? What do you do when your money becomes funny?
Yeah.
What do you do when family walks away from you?
Come on, preacher.
See, this woman, this widow, this mother decided to obey and trust God. This is the moment in our own lives that we must examine. It's easy to look and point fingers. But what do you do when the bondsman is coming to take your children? Wonder if you are willing to really trust God. If you're willing to really extend on his word. If you really can understand that the check you was dependent on might not be ever issued again. I wonder if you're willing still to trust in God. I wonder if you're willing to trust in God when the pain within your body becomes more persistent. I wonder if you're willing to still trust in God. When it seems your unemployment opportunities begin to narrow. I wonder how much faith do you have? This is the mother who obeyed the word of the Lord.
Yes, sir.
This is the mother who was afraid that her sons be taken into slavery. This is the mother that allowed God to use what she simply had.
Yes,
this is the mother that put herself in position for God to get the victory.
Yes,
it is at this juncture of our test that we can look and see that God did provide.
Yes,
it is at this particular part of our text where we can look and say God used what the widow had to show his glory. It is at this particular moment that we're able to recognize that God took a little that was already inside of us. And he began to increase it beyond her means. We ourselves need to examine what God has to work with. We ourselves need to change what we put inside of our house. We ourselves have to change our conversation of speaking negatively. We ourselves can no longer say, I can barely sing, or I'm not good at praying. I'm not that good at reading the Bible, nor preaching. God uses has a purpose.
Yes, sir.
Each and one of us has something within our hearts. Each and every one of us has something within our own bodies that God can use. Don't allow your hesitation to allow God to use you. It might delay your victory. It might delay your victory. It might delay, hey, thank you, Jesus. It might delay your victory. There is a single mother that's waiting for your testimony. Your hesitation might delay the victory of a young man from knowing that what he did is just a moment. It might delay that young man from knowing that he's wonderfully made. It might delay that man from knowing that the decisions that he made doesn't control him for the rest of his life. It might delay that young man from knowing that he can make better decisions. Your hesitation and not allowing God to use you might even delay your own church from becoming a better place for people to reach. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hey, thank you, Jesus. When we begin to apply ourselves, when we begin to apply ourselves, you stay consistent. You stay consistent. You stay consistent. You stay consistent. Hey.
Yes, sir.
See, it's one thing to really understand and you hear the word and then to understand and to apply it.
Yes, sir.
But oh, that widow. If we would get a hold of that widow later in life, you can understand how David began to compose Psalms 37 and 25. She sat with her and he understood her plight. Oh, how many other mothers that have a testimony? How many other fathers have a testimony? Do you yourself have a testimony? Psalms 37 and 25. Oh, simply says, I was young and now that I am old. Yet I have never seen the righteous forsaken. Here was that widow, that mother that had nothing, didn't know what was going to happen. Sons were taken in for slavery. Any minute the bondsman was on her way. But oh, look at her now. Hey. She would give you advice and says, I was young. Didn't quite know what was going to happen. But now that I am old, and in that period of time, I've never seen the righteous forsaken. Nor were their children begged for bread. It was in the songwriter that Timothy Wright put together the song that trouble don't last always. I am so glad that trouble don't last always. I am so glad that trouble don't last always. May not come when you want it, but he's all time. In times of trouble, I found him to be a friend of mine. In the times of storm clouds arising, he will be there at all time. All of your burdens, all of your burdens, all of your burdens, the Lord will hear and carry your burdens. I'm so glad that trouble don't last always. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. No more cloudy days. No more cloudy days. No more cloudy days. They all are gone. Hey, I feel that I can make it. The storm is over now. Hey, the storm is over now. No more sleepless nights. No tonight. They're all gone. I feel that I can make it. I feel that I can make it. I feel that I can make it. The storm is over now. The storm is over now. Even if I feel that I'm all by myself, even if I feel that I'm walking all alone, I know that I'm not on my own. The storm is over. The storm is over. I feel that I can make it. The storm is over. The storm is over. The storm is over. Hey, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. 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 Hey, hey, hey. Remember, God knows what you're going through. God knows what you're going through. God knows what you're going through. God knows every one of those disappointments. Every one of those disappointments. Every one of those heartaches. Every one of those heartaches. Sometimes, even within our homes, we are trying to hold on together. We're trying to understand, but there are moments when we feel let down. There's moments when we feel disappointed. God knows every one of your heartaches. You're not by yourself. God knows. God sees every tear that runs down your face. God knows. God knows. No more weariness. No more apprehension. No more worrying about uncertainty. God knows. God knows. No more anguish. God knows. God knows. No more feeling hopelessness. God knows. God knows. No more despair. God knows. God knows. No more anxiety. Hey, 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 thank you, Jesus. God knows. God knows. Hey, we just have to examine what's in our house. We have to examine what's in our hearts.
Yes, sir.
We have to examine what thoughts are in our minds.
Yes, sir.
We need to examine what gift is inside of us that God can use. Huh? What gift is inside of us that God can use? What gift has God given you? What gift has God given you? What gift has He planted inside of you? And the question is, will you allow God to use your gift? Will you allow God to use your gift? Will you allow God to use your gift to build His kingdom? Will you allow God to use your gift? Will you allow God to use your gift to help bring together your families? Will you allow God to use your gift? Will you allow Him to use your gift to make a difference within our communities? Would you allow God? Would you allow God to use your gift? That you would help build your local church. Will you trust God? Will you trust God? That widow had nothing left. Her husband had passed away. That woman who was vulnerable didn't know where to go next. That mother who was aching in her heart. The bondsman had seen word and says, if you don't have my money, I'm taking both of your kids. He didn't say, I'll just take one for now and come back for the later. He says, if you don't have my money, make it personal. If you do not have my money, I'm going to take both of your kids. These are the kids that she had raised. These are the kids that she loved with all of her heart. Don't you know the devil was speaking to you? Don't you know that if you don't get right with God, He's coming to take everything that you got? He starting with your mind and wherever he can disrupt. He's trying to pull away. The war and the fight is not between me and you. The devil is coming to take that. What is our decision? What do we have? What are we allowing God to use? God knows what we're going through. All we got to do is trust on him.
Yes, sir.
See, uncertainty, despair, and anxiety, it's just temporary. Uncertainty, despair, and anxiety is just temporary. It's temporary when you trust God. It's temporary when you trust God. That same God that delivered you from years. Oh, you count your own clock. I ain't got to go back to 1980, 1975, 1992, 2001. That same God that delivered you. Hey, that same God that delivered you. To him, 2021 is just another year.
Yes, sir.
That same God, that same God, that same God. Hey, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. She put it all on the line. And part of that within our text, she began to speak. She says, my husband was faithful. My husband believed. My husband knew that there was a God. Oh, man of God. Have mercy on me.
Yes, sir.
Have mercy on me.
Yes, sir.
And the one thing I love about God, he don't just do nothing, just enough. Exceedingly, abundantly.
All right.
Huh? Read the seventh verse. He says, now you're not only going to have enough to get the bondsmen away from you, but now I want you to take the rest and go live.
Yes, sir.
The oil didn't stop just when they had enough to pay their bills, just to stop when they had everything they needed, but they gave them more. Hey, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. That's why I speak that we are lenders and not borrowers.
Yes, sir.
That's why I speak no weapon formed against us. Hey, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. That's why I speak Isaiah 41 and 10. Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. He says, I will strengthen you and help you. He says, I will uphold my righteous hand for you. This is the God that we serve. It is at this moment that we must examine our own house. We have the structure that we have to get in order, and then our own bodies ourselves. What we have allowed to come. It is a double meaning because not only do we need to examine what has taken us away, but what we will allow God to use. No longer can we hide behind someone else. Let God use you. Let God use you. What you have is exactly what God needs. What you have for him to have you engage is exactly what God needs. God, would you call me in a certain position? God, I don't know if I can do that. Don't you know there is someone that has been prepped just for you? You fit the bill, custodially made. Before we take our communion, we want to pause and give you time that you may reflect on your own lives. We want to take the time that we may can understand that we ourselves have an opportunity to get right. We want to take the time that we ourselves can make a difference by getting ourselves right with God. This is the moment, this is the time that we are allowed to self-examine ourselves. Often we look at the other person to our left and to our right, but this time, I want us to reflect on our own self. Here's an opportunity that you can say, God, help me. God, save me. God, forgive me. You might not know God in your life today, but this is the time that you can say, God, save me. I want to come for you. Right before we take our virtual communion, we want to pause, just a light prayer as we prepare. Heavenly Father, those who have a desire, those who want to take their communion, Lord, we ask you to forgive them of anything that they might have done. Lord, put them within your own mind. Give them the faith and understanding. You are yet on the throne. Your mercy and grace run abroad. And they simply say, forgive me, Lord. They simply say, save me, Lord. For those who come to you, Lord, that knows without a shadow of doubt that they believe on you, Lord, continue to encourage them. Continue to guide them. Continue to lead them. And thank you for preparing them. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. We take this moment to honor God, and we do this in remembrance of Him. We take this moment that we may remember the sacrifice that He made on the cross. I'm going to tell you to get your chalice or your small piece of bread or cracker. I want you to get your water. I want you to get your juice. I want you to get ready as we take our virtual communion. Oh, the blood of Jesus.
Miracles that we have prayed for we stand on that word. Deliver right now.
that hopelessness, ease that despair. Give us, Lord, the peace of mind. Allow us to continue to serve. We will give you all praise. We will give you all honor and glory. Those who are seeing us right now that might be incarcerated, give them grace. Give them strength. Those that have a desire that still feel isolated. They have a desire to come, but there is an understanding fear. Give them comfort. Those who are leaning on your word, not sure of the results, give them peace in their mind right now. You still have the victory, and we give you all honor and glory. Protect them, Lord, as you say in Psalms, hide them as in your pavilion. We give you all honor and glory. In my son Jesus' name, amen and amen. Well, Unity, as we begin to end our service, raise our right hand and say, as we say unto one, we say unto all, watch and pray. I am still concerned, so I'm asking you to watch your hands. I love you.
On behalf of Pastor and First Lady Rogers, thank you for joining us today. Please stand by for our announcements for the week. Following service today, from 1:30 p.m. to 2:30 p.m., Pastor and Lady Rogers are inviting you to join them and your Unity Church family on Zoom for First Sunday Fellowship. Everyone is welcome. Please check your email for Zoom details. Tuesday, join us for our weekly intercessory call at 6:30 p.m. Dial-in information is available at unitykojic.org and on our Facebook page. On Wednesday, join us on Facebook Live at 6:30 p.m. for Bible study with Pastor Anthony Rogers. Morning Coffee with Lady Rogers is on Saturday, May 8th, from 8:30 a.m. to 9:30 a.m. Eventbrite sign-up information is available on our Facebook page or unitykojic.org. Due to limited seating capacity, please sign up soon to reserve your space. The Washington Northwest Ecclesiastical Jurisdiction Annual Women's Convention is Thursday, May 13th and Friday, May 14th. Women's Day is Thursday with guest speaker Supervisor Diane Bogan from Michigan Southwest First. And Friday is official day, and the speaker is our very own prelate, Bishop Reginald C. Witherspoon. The convention will culminate with the Supervisors Fellowship and Scholarship Benefit in celebration of our very own supervisor, Mother Mary Jean McGraw. Everyone is welcome to attend. Registration is open now for $10 at dowbenefit.eventbrite.com. Helen's Pantry will be distributing free groceries on Saturday, May 22nd from 12 p.m. to 3 p.m. We are asking for cash donations to purchase fresh food items for the giveaway. You can make your cash donation via Giblify. Thank you for your support. To stay current on these and upcoming events, we invite you to subscribe to our Facebook page and sign up to receive our email updates. To join the Unity Kojic family, go to unitykojic.org. That is unitykojic.org. And remember, for with God nothing shall be impossible. May God bless you and have a great week.